IAS 16 property plan and equipment, which talks about depreciation. And if there is no reasonable certainty that the lease will obtain on the lessee will obtain the ownership by the end of the lease term, then the asset shall be fully depreciated over the shorter period of lease term and its useful life. So here it want to say that even if the title eventually at the end will not be transferred to the lessee, but lessee is utilizing the asset and the risk and reward has been transferred for a substantial period of time. In that case, whatever the time, even if it is a shorter time as compared to the whole useful life of the asset, then the lessee need to fully depreciate the asset over that shorter period of the lease term. After understanding of how we do the recognition and measurement of assets in case of finance lease in books of lessee, let's see what are the important disclosure requirements. The disclosure is the lessee need to show the net carrying amount at the end of the reporting period for each such class of asset. There should be also a reconciliation between the total of the future MLPs at the end of the reporting period and their present value. And in addition of this reconciliation, the entity shall also disclose the total future minimum lease payments at the end of the reporting period and their present value for each of the following periods. So what if it is falling not more than 1 year? What if it is falling later than 1 year but not later than 5 years? So it is from 1 to 5 years and later than 5 years. Also, there are more disclosures around it, which is like contingent rent, which is recognized as an expense in books of lessee during the period, the total of future minimum sublease payments. So it could be the case that there is a sublease arrangement or agreement. Then in that case, a disclosure needs to be given that how much expected amount to be received under the non-cancellable sublease at the end of the reporting period. Any general description of the lease material, leasing arrangements including but not limited to the that what is the basis of contingent rent which is payable, because contingent rent is based on the future market indexes, future interest rate, future conditions, sales, profit, etc. So as a disclosure, it is very important to mention that what is the basis of contingent rent. If there is any existence of the term of purchase option and the escalation clause are there in the agreement, that need to be disclosed. Also, if there is any restriction in the lease agreement, restriction with respect to the sublease, restriction with respect to its usage and transfer, any restriction which is imposed in the lease agreement, that also need to be disclosed. Now let's move to the lease accounting in books of lessee if it is a case of operating lease. So how the recognition will be done? So the lease payment shall be recognized very simply as an expense on the straight line basis over the lease term, unless any other systematic basis is more usable or representative of a time pattern of user benefit. So if you see in case of operating lease, first of all you need to calculate MLP, minimum lease payment, and then whatever the MLP amount, the present value of MLP comes up, that is the total value, and you need to apportion, you need to recognize as an expense on a straight line basis over the lease term that amount to your SCI, which is statement of comprehensive income, or your profit and loss account. Here the lease payment again exclude the cost of service such as insurance and maintenance expenses. As in case of finance lease also, we mentioned that it excludes the contingent rent and any indirect cost or also the taxes, etc. So here the accounting is simple, because this is as good as just rather than the asset will fall in the books of lessee, it will be as good as just an expense. So what are the disclosure requirements here? So lessee shall make the disclosure like what is the total of the future minimum lease payment for each of the following period, same which is not later than 1 year or 1 to 5 year and later than 5 year, and what is the total future minimum sublease payment which is expected to receive at the end of the reporting period. Also, the disclosure is required by the lessee in case of operating lease when of the lease and the sublease payment which is recognized as an expense in the period with a separate amount of MLPs or if there is contingent rent and the sublease payment. A journal description in the same way of the lease, significantly leasing arrangement, which include but not limited to, again, the basis of contingent rent payable, any existence in the terms of purchase option and escalation clauses, and if there is any restriction in the lease arrangement. Now, we are done with the books of lessee, so let's move to the books of lessor. How we do the lease accounting in books of lessor if it is a case of finance lease? So let's understand what would be the situation in this case. The lessor has given the asset to the lessee on a finance lease, so it is reflecting as an asset in books of lessor. How we do the initial recognition and measurement? So the lessor shall recognize the asset which is held under a finance lease in SOFP and present them as a, not an asset, but receivable at an amount equal to the net investment in the lease. Because now it is a receivable for the lessor from the lessee. So initial recognition will be done as a receivable at the net investment or value. And how the subsequent measure will be done? Subsequently, the lessor will recognize the finance income, which is based on the pattern reflecting on the constant periodic rate of return on the lesser net investment in the finance lease. So over the lease term, this receivable which is standing in the books of lessee will be hit to the as a finance income to your statement of comprehensive income. Let's see, you know, how if it is a case, in case of lessor, no doubt under the finance lease, the accounting which need to be done by lessor or even the manufacturer or dealer. This has been covered separately because it says that sometime it happens that when we go to in the market and as a lessee, we go to the, for example, the motor vehicles industries, or we go to the big cars dealers like Kona and maybe the BMW and all. So these manufacturers and dealers sometimes given assets on in two ways: outrightly sales, then we make the payment and we buy it. On other hand, they offer sometimes an artificial lower rate of interest. So in this particular case, we need to, as an accounting standpoint of view, we need to bifurcate that how much should be the selling price if it is an outright sale, and if there is a lower rate of interest which has been charged, that means there is hidden in the sale price itself. So we need to bifurcate, and similarly we would apply the market rate of interest rather than the lower rate of interest in that particular case to do the accounting in books of manufacturer or the dealer. Because this is somehow a marketing strategy to sell the asset, that that the person needs to pay the lower rate of interest. So how the accounting needs to be done if a manufacturer or dealer or lessor is selling an asset to the lessee? The manufacturer, dealer, lessor shall recognize selling profit and loss in the period in accordance with the policy which is followed by the entity for the outright sale. So it says that, you know, consider it as good as on the arm length price as an outright sale, and accordingly recognize the selling profit and loss in the period. And if artificially lower rate of interest are quoted, then selling profit shall be restricted to that which would apply if the market rate of interest were changed. Here, the cost incurred which in connection with the negotiating and arranging a lease shall be recognized as an expense when the selling profit is recognized. So, the cost which is related to or in connection with the negotiation or arranging or anything need to, you know, is incurred by the lessor, then that will be taken to the profit and loss account, because that is more around the marketing and the selling expenses rather than considering it in the cost of the asset.
So here the counting is important to note down that again the concept of substance over form stands up. So it says in substance, if you see the artificial lower rates is need to be taken into account, and that's why the market rate of interest should be considered for the basis of calculation rather than just going by the lower rate of interest. What are the disclosures under a finance lease in books of lessor need to be done? So a lessor should disclose the following for the finance lease. First, a reconciliation between the gross investment in the lease at the end of the reporting period and the present value of minimum lease payments which is receivable at the end of the reporting period. Here it is same as in books of lessee. However, in books of lessee, in case of finance lease, now the asset is in books of lessee, and that's why in the disclosure requirement it was mentioned that the lessee need to show the net carrying value of the asset. Now in case of finance lease, since the asset is not in books of lessor, and that's why the lessor need to disclose a reconciliation of the gross investment, it is done in the lease agreement, and the present value of minimum lease payment which the lessor will receive over the period of the lease term. In addition, an entity shall also disclose the gross investment in the lease and the present value of minimum lease payment at the end of the reporting period for each period. Like similarly, which is not later than 1 year, that is within 1 year, from 1 to 5 years and later than 5 years. Some other disclosure requirements are also there, like how much is the earned on finance income, how much is the balancing figure with respect to that receivable, the unguaranteed residual value if it is accruing to the benefit of lessor, so how much is the amount of that unguaranteed residual value, the accumulated allowance for the uncollected minimum lease payment receivable, the contingent rent which is the contingent in the period, and a general description of the lessor material, the description again that is the basis of the calculation, the type of asset, there is a restriction clause, then disclose the lessor. So lessor need to do the accounting in case of operating lease. Now here is the case that the lessor has the asset in its book and has given it to the lessee just for the purpose of operating or usage for a shorter period of time, or you can say wherein the risk and reward has not been completely transferred to the lessee. So the lessor shall present the asset subject to the operating lease in the statement of financial position according to the nature of asset, and the lease income from the operating lease shall be recognized in the income on the straight line basis over the lease term. You know, until and unless there is another systematic basis which is representative of the time pattern in which the benefit derived from the lease asset is diminishing. So as in books of lessee, it is an expense which is also over the period of the time on a straight line basis. Similarly, in books of lessor, it is income from the operating lease and recognized as an income on the straight line basis. There are important key notes related to the operating lease in books of lessor, wherein it says that if there is any indirect cost incurred by the lessor, then that shall be added to the carrying amount of the lease asset. I should say initial direct cost, no, not the indirect cost. So this initial direct cost is initially any cost which is directly attributable to the arrangement of the lease, then that should also be added to the carrying value of the lease asset and recognized as an expense over the lease term on the same basis as the lease income. The depreciation policy is again here, since the asset is in books of lessor, so it applies the depreciation according to the respective international accounting standard. What is the disclosure requirement? Here the same, very simple, the disclosure requirement is that the future MLPs in the aggregate for each of the following period, not less than 1 year, 1 to 5 years and 5 years, and also total contingent rent which has been recognized as an income in the period. So the lessor under an operating lease should disclose these two important aspects. Moving to the concept of sale and lease back. In general, what we understand by the sale and the lease back, that if you have an asset, you have given it or you sell it to someone else and you take it on the lease back for your operation. And in business, what is generally happening? So for example, if you have a crisis and it is a, you know, so rather than having that asset, you sell that asset to someone, and since that asset is very much mandatory for your operations to run, you buy it back, I shouldn't say buy it back, but taken it on lease. So there could be two options. Either you buy it back, that means a finance lease, or either you just take it on operation. And that is the concept of sale and lease back. So how the accounting needs to be done in this particular case? So in case of sale and lease back under the finance lease, if a sale or the leaseback transaction result in a finance lease, any excess of the sale proceed over the carrying amount shall not be immediately recognized as income by the seller lease. Instead, it shall be deferred and amortized over the lease term. Because if there is a sale and leaseback transaction, and that too of a nature of finance lease, it means it is as good as an arrangement of loan. You have taken loan on your asset. So the asset will still remain in the books of the lessee. The lessee will charge the depreciation, and whatever the charges the lessee is paying under this arrangement is as good as the finance cost and the interest cost. And if it is not case of the finance lease, that means the lessee has not taken the asset altogether back from the lessor, then it will fall under the operating lease. And if a sale or lease back transaction is resulting in an operating lease, then it is very clear, and if it is very clear from the transaction that it is established at the fair value, that means the actual sales has happened, then any profit and loss shall be recognized immediately. But in this particular case, it may be the situation that either the sale is done at more than the fair value, and it may be the case if it is less than the fair value. Then how to do the accounting of the sale? No doubt it is an operating lease wherein the asset is not now in the books of lessee, it is in the books of lessor. But still, if the price is higher than the fair value, then how to account for it? And if the price is less than the fair value, how to account for it? So if the sale price is below the fair value, then any profit and loss shall be recognized immediately, except that if the loss is compensated by the future lease payment at a below market price, it shall be deferred or amortized in the proportion to the lease payment over the period for which the asset is expected to be used. So in this case, it want to highlight that it could be the case that actually the asset has been sold at loss, and that's why the lessee need to book a loss. However, if it is actually not the case and this amount is compensating through the future lease payment by the lessor from the lessee, then that need to be deferred in the proportion to the lease payment over the period of the lease term. And if the sale price is above the fair value, then the excess over the fair value shall be deferred and amortized over the period for which the asset is expected to be used. So in this particular case, since the selling price is more than the fair value, it means there is excess charge, and that excess should be over the period of the lease term. So let's summarize the sale and lease back transaction. In the case of sale and leaseback transaction, if it is a finance lease, so I explained to you that this is as good as a loan which you have taken on the asset. So it is loan securitized by the asset. So here the seller
or the initial the lessee will keep the asset. The final lease liability will be there, and if the selling price is greater than the carrying amount, then that needs to be deferred over the lease term. On the other hand, in operating lease, simply if it is an arm length basis, it is a fair value sale, then the profit needs to be recognized immediately in the P&L. However, if it is below the fair value, then we need to see the market rentals that will be recognized immediately in the P&L. But if the rentals is below the market price, and then that needs to be deferred, the loss over the lease term. At the end, if it is a sale above the fair value, then the difference of the market value to the carrying value recognized immediately in the profit and loss account, and the excess of the fair value is deferred over the lease term. So this is how the accounting is done in case of the sale and lease back transaction. Here also we need to distinguish whether it is a finance lease and an operating lease. Now, this was all around IAS 17 when we started with understanding of the objective, the scope, key important definitions of lease, how we do the recognition and measurement, wherein we need to calculate the minimum lease payment, and that followed by the accounting in books of lessor and the lessee, also in disclosure requirements for a manufacturer and dealer or the lessor. We have seen that if they have made a sale on a lower rate of interest, how to deal with the same, and how in case of a sale and lease back transaction, if it is a finance lease and operating lease, we need to do the accounting. Before we move on to the Q&A session, it's very important, guys, let's see that what IFRS 16, which is a new standard on lease, talks about. So IAS 17, which was the original standard, closed many loopholes in the treatment of leases, as I explain you about the concept of substance over form. But it was still open to manipulations, because in case of operating lease, basically the lessee were not, in spite of the fact that using the asset has the right to use the asset, but still the asset was not in the books of the lessee, and there was used to be an off balance sheet item. And thus IFRS 16 leases brings more transparency on the lease asset and the liability. So as per the new IFRS 16, you will see that the off balance sheet items will be more shown in the book. There will be high asset values will be in the book, and on the other hand there will be liabilities also which will be there in the book. So IFRS 16, as I told you, is effective from on and after 1st January 2019. The intention of IFRS 16 is to cover more off-balance sheet items in the books of lessee. Recognition is done as a right to use the asset and the lease liability for all leases. The major highlight says that for lease, new IFRS follow dual recognition approach, wherein the type of lease is based on the amount of consumption of underlying assets. So for lessee, it is a major change. That's why for many industries, as I initially told you, like airlines, telecommunication, and travel and leisure and all, from the lessee perspective, it's going to be a major change, because it is now not based on whether it is an operating and finance lease. It is based on a dual recognition approach, wherein the type of lease is based on the amount of consumption of underlying assets. For lesser, the accounting is almost same, because lesser accounting for finance lease is similar, which is existing of IAS 17. Lesser accounting for operating lease is changed only with respect to the spirit of new IFRS 16. If you see the impact of the lease in the financial statement, it is to report larger amount of assets and liabilities in the financial statement. So this was all around the concept of lease and the lease accounting, which is covered under IAS 17 and IFRS 16. Try to do the practical
questions around IFRS 16 and I should say IS 17, which is given in your material. And if you have any questions, feel free to ask me through Q&A session. Thank you very much, everyone. Have a good learning with ICT. Enjoy and understand the accounting world through the understanding of International Financial Reporting Standards.